Welcome to today's GOAT seminar. Our today's speaker is Abhishek Sahu, who will speak about dynamic parameterized problems.
Nice to meet you all. So today I'll be presenting one of our paper, this dynamic parameterized problems that we had written in 2016. It was joint work with Kritika and Pratik. So usually in dynamic problems, usually in dynamic problems, what we do is our input instance, it keeps changing, and we have to store some information such that we can retrieve the optimal solution really fast. But the problem template that we work on, it's not so. In this case, we, along with an input instance, we are also giving a solution. The solution need not be an optimal solution. Now your input instance changes slightly, and you have to find a new solution that is as close to the original solution as possible. So it's slightly different. Most of the problems that we have solved in the paper involves graphs. So suppose we have a problem instance where we are given a graph G and an integer Q, and our question is, does G have a solution S of size less than equal to K for any problem? So its dynamic version of this problem will be, along with graph G, we are also given a solution S. And now our graph changes slightly. There are some KH modifications to this graph G, and we get a new graph H. And in the new graph, we have to find this S may not be a solution to the new graph, right? So in the new graph, we have to construct a new solution, T, which is as close to S as possible. So we define this distance between both these graphs as K, and the distance between both these solutions is R. So K we will call edit parameter, and R we will call distance parameter. Okay, so this is like a dynamic graph. So initially this will be your input graph where a solution is given. Then there are some edges that will be deleted, some edges that will be inserted. And after some time, you have a new graph. So if you look at both these graphs, like 8 edges are different from one graph to the other. So the edit distance is 8 here. And if you look at vertex cover instance, initially you had all these red vertices as your vertex cover. And in the new graph, if you take the same set to be your vertex cover, it doesn't work. And hence you have to add some extra vertex. This gray vertex, you have to add it. Okay, so the Hamming distance between both these solutions is 1. Okay, so the questions that we solve is, given a dynamic version of a problem, is it NP-hard? Is it fixed parameter tractable? Or does it have a polynomial kernel? All these questions we will solve in our paper. And we solve some very basic problems. So, if you know about the normal problem, like the hardness of the normal problem, can we conclude something about the dynamic problem? So it turns out that we can indeed say something, but there are certain conditions. So the first condition is, if we are looking for a solution, so suppose your input instance is G, where you are looking for a solution set S such that G minus S belong to certain graph plus pi. If this pi property is hereditary, that means if S is solution to G, S is also solution to any subgraph of G, then we call this pi property hereditary. So if your pi property is hereditary, and you have all possible cliques or all possible independent sets in pi, then the hardness translates. Then you can say that if the general problem is NP-hard, then the dynamic version is also NP-hard. Let's see how we can do that. So from the general version, we'll construct the dynamic, general problem, will reduce it to the dynamic problem. So you start with an empty graph. Your an empty set SEO solution, because all independent sets, they belong to this file, and empty set is also a solution. Now the new instance will be the actual graph, the M edges that will be added to the original instance. And in the new graph, you are looking for any solution S prime that has distance K to S. And hence the original problem reduces to this dynamic problem. And you can show that if original problem is NP hard, dynamic problem is also NP hard. If original problem is W hard, dynamic problem will be W hard. If original problem is no polykernel, the dynamic problem will have no polykernel. So all these things will be translated, provided all independent sets or all clicks belong to this graph plus path. So in case all clicks belong to this graph plus pi, what you can do, start with a complete graph G, and then you delete some edges, and you get to your required graph. And when you had this complete graph as your initial graph, you knew that it belonged to pi, so your S was empty. Is that okay? I can go a bit slower, like if it's difficult to. Okay. It's fine. So this is this click thing. How do we convert the general problem instance to a dynamic problem instance? So suppose your general problem instance is some g comma k. Now in dynamic problem instance, what you'll do? You'll turn this G into a complete graph. That is your initial graph. And your second graph is the actual graph G. In the initial graph, because initial graph belong to this pi graph class, you have an empty solution. And in the new graph, you are looking for a solution that has size something less than equal to R or L. So the general problem, you can reduce to the dynamic problem. And again, you can say that if this problem is NP hard, the other problem is also NP hard. All this hardness results will be translated to the dynamic instance. So these are some of the problems that we solved. The white ones are the problems, results that were there previously, and the blue ones are the result that we improved. And then we'll go into these problems one by one. So like if you have any confusion, like you can ask.
So R is the edit distance?
Edit distance is the symmetric difference between the first graph and the modified graph.
And the parameter, the k is the solution size or the
Okay.
Which one is the distance between the two graphs, and R is the distance between the two solutions.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes. Okay. So let's look at this dynamic vertex cover problem. So initially, along with this graph on the left side, you were given a solution S, right? So it covered all these edges. Now you added some edges, you deleted some edges. So if you remove some edges, it's fine. Don't matter to our solution. The only edges that we are concerned about are the newly added edges. We still have to cover them, right? And moreover, what you can show, the S prime or the new solution that you are looking for, it should completely contain S. Because if it doesn't contain S, you can always add that element to your S prime. The symmetric difference will be less, and it will cover something extra. So first condition is S prime always contains S. After that, what you can do, delete S from your graph. Like delete all the edges that are covered by this S. And if you look at the additional edges, there can be at most some k many edges, because only k many edges you are adding, which may not be covered by this S, right? So you have a problem instance where there are k edges and you have to cover them by some vertex cover. So you have a kernel that has k edges and that has at most 2k many endpoints, 2k many new vertices, because each edge can have 2 endpoints, right? So you have a kernel for this problem instance. So if you apply the general vertex cover algorithm, so what? So k is the edit distance and r is the hemming distance. So the kernel has size 2k vertex and k edge, and you are looking for a solution of size r there, r size vertex cover. So you can apply the normal vertex cover algorithm and solve it in 1.27 power r algorithm, like which is the best known FPT algorithm for vertex cover. But if you parameterize by the slightly larger parameter k, can we do something better? So it turns out that we can indeed solve it better than 1.27 power r. We can solve it in 1.174 power k. So here, when you are solving vertex cover, your parameter is the number of edges that are in the graph, right? So, so in dynamic vertex cover, after we delete edges, what are we left with? We have k edges and we have 2k vertices. This is your new graph where you are trying to find a solution of size r, right? So parameterized by r, you already know there is an algorithm 1.27 power r, and you can always show that k value is k value should be less than r. Like from every edge you can take one endpoint, it forms a vertex cover, right? So you can show that one of these values is less than the other, and for the other parameter also you will be able to get an algorithm, right? But the question is, if you don't want to parameterize by r the solution size, but if you want to parameterize by this other parameter k, can you do better? So the question is, you have a graph G where number of edges you know k and number of vertices you know 2k, and now you are finding vertex cover parameterized by number of edges k. So we can design a branching algorithm. So whatever we do for vertex cover, delete independent vertices, if there is a degree one vertex, you include its neighbor to your solution, all these things you do. After that, you have a graph where the degree is at least 2. And if all the vertices have degree 2, again, you can show that you can solve it in polynomial time. So there must be a vertex that has degree more than 2. Now, what we do, the next step is we'll make this graph triangle free. For the time being, there are no degree 1 or degree 2 vertices. No degree 0 or degree 1 vertices. Your graph has only degree 2 and more than degree 2 vertices. Next step will be to make the graph triangle free. Like we'll see why we need this. So suppose that there is a triangle ABC and A has degree 2, then you never, like you shouldn't put A into your vertex cover, because from ABC triplet you need at least 2 vertices, and choosing B and C is always preferable than choosing A, right? So you can include this B and C directly, and it will be a reduction rule. So if in your triangle there is a vertex of degree 2, you know exactly what to do. Otherwise, all your vertices have degree at least 2. So then we will branch on this vertex A. Either we put A into our solution, or we put neighborhood of A into our solution. So when we put A into our solution, how many edges will we lose from our graph? In our graph, we will delete some edges, right, when we select A. So if you look at this graph, we lose these 3 edges, at least these 3 edges. And if you don't include A, we know that we have to include B, C, X, all 3 of them. Then in that case, we lose at least 6 edges. So it's a 3,6 branch. And 3,6 branching, it gives runtime better than 1.27 power k. It gives runtime 1.13 power k. So suppose now there are no triangles. In that case, so here we handle all these two types of triangles. In the first case, we know exactly what to do. We include directly B and C into our solution. In the second case, we do a branch. So we know if there's a triangle, how to proceed. If your graph doesn't have any triangles, look at any degree three vertex. A is a degree three vertex, and there are these vertices B, C, X. Again, here you can apply your branching, and you'll get a 3.6 branching factor. So this gives you a 1.17 fold power k algorithm. That's a way to improve it using DP. There's a bound on this tree width. If you look at this bound, tree width is some order log n plus m by some value. So if you put your, because in your kernel you have 2k vertices and k edges, you can directly put 2k and k here, and you have a very small tree width graph. You can directly apply your vertex cover algorithm parameterized by tree width, some DP algorithm. And that DP algorithm has runtime 2-power tree width. If you put tree width is equal to some k by 5.769 here, you'll get this runtime. But here the space is exponential because you have to store the DP entries. In the previous case, you don't need to store the DP entries. So even if the runtime was worse there, you still have a polynomial space algorithm. Okay. So in vertex cover, we were able to say that if S was my original solution, like S was my solution to the first graph, S prime must include S. We can't say it for this connected versions because you might be removing some vertices that disconnects this vertex cover into chunks, and you might need a lot of vertices to connect them. Right? So here, if you look at the graph on the left, S is a connected vertex cover. Now you added some edges and deleted some edges. So the edges that are added in S, that should not be a problem. The edges that are added outside S, you have to cover those edges. And the edges that are removed from within S, they might create a problem. Because your vertex cover, this S set now no longer remains connected. You have to keep them connected, right? So what we can do, first here also we'll show that S prime must contain S. Suppose not. Suppose there is a vertex here that is not contained in S, not contained in S prime. Let's say this vertex is A, and A is not part of S prime, but S prime is a vertex cover. So all neighbors of A are in S prime, right? So then if you include A into S prime, it still remains connected, and the Hamming distance further decreases. Because this vertex A was originally there in S. If you delete it from S prime, there's a Hamming distance increase by one. If you keep it, Hamming distance doesn't increase. So the first thing we show is S should be completely contained inside S prime. After that, this problem instance, it reduces to this group Steiner tree problem. Basically, if you look at here, what you are doing is you are trying to connect certain components via Steiner tree. If you look at these edges, like both these endpoints, you have to take at least one of them into your solution, right? So, and you also have to connect the components that have been disconnected due to the edge removals. So this is like there are many components, and you have to find a Steiner tree that connects all these components. So this problem is exactly group Steiner tree problem, and you apply, if you apply that algorithm, you'll be able to get some 2-power k runtime algorithm for this dynamic connected vertex. So like, is everything okay so far? The instances are really simple. So, okay. Okay. So, in a dynamic dominating set, again, if you look at the left side of your graph, you have a dominating set, and now some edges are added, some edges are deleted. So if the edges are added, you have no problem because you are covering something extra. The problem is if there is a vertex that was covered earlier, and if you are deleting this edge. But since you know the number of edge operations is k, you are uncovering at most k many elements, right? And to now in a new solution, you have to cover these k elements. So you can think of this as a set cover problem, where your universe has size k, and you have some like if you look at all these vertices in D, you can turn their neighborhood into this family, universe and family thing. So and there is a there is already this 2-power U mod algorithm known for this hitting set problem. So you can apply that directly, and you can get a 2-power k algorithm. This and this algorithm is also tight. Like you can't do better than 2-power k. So the reduction is like this. So here, first of all, you reduce this dynamic dominating set to set cover problem. Now you will also reduce set cover problem to dynamic dominating set problem to show that both these problems are equivalent. So suppose this is your set cover instance. You have this universe U and you have this family F, and you have two sets. F1 is BC, F2 is AD, and you are looking for k sets that together will cover all the elements in U. So how you will turn it into this dynamic dominating set instance? So your left side is the initial graph G, where for every element in U, you introduce a vertex, and for every family, like for every set in F, also you introduce a vertex. This is A, D, B, C should be there. BF1, BF2, and initially there are no edges here. So you have a dominating set of size U mod plus P of F mod. After that, in your modified graph, what you do, if F1 contained this vertex B and C, you draw edges from B of F1 to B and C. This way, you construct your new graph, and in your, I've written S is empty. Here S should be U plus B of F, like all the vertices should be in your dominating set. And in your new graph, this new graph, you are looking for a solution of size k. So if you want a hitting set of size k, in the second graph, you have to exactly find a dominating set of size k. Is it easy to see why these two things are equivalent? Hitting set here of size k implies a dominating set here of size k. See, if you want a dominating set here in the right graph, you shouldn't pick anything from the side of U. Like, why are you going to pick anything from U? The same, like, you can always pick some neighbor of A on the right hand side, and you might cover something extra also. So first thing you can show is there is an optimal solution. Well, all your solution elements, they come from this right side, V of F. And if you have a k-size solution here, that means there are k vertices here that together dominate everything. And same, the sets corresponding to these k vertices, they will cover the entire universe U. So this is the construction. And here we showed that set cover is set cover you can reduce to this dynamic dominating set problem, and hence both these problems are equivalent. So this 2-power k algorithm, and also it is tight under set cover concepts, and both the problems are exactly equivalent. So dynamic connected dominating set also you can show similarly, like it's very similar to this dynamic connected vertex cover. Like again, it reduces to this Steiner tree problem, and you can get an algorithm running in time 2-power k. And like here in dynamic dominating set, we showed a reduction from this set cover instance to dynamic dominating set. Can we use this same construction to show another reduction from set cover to dynamic connected dominating set? Here, if we wanted a connected dominating set, in the first case, what we can do, we can add a universal vertex here, X, that together, like that dominates everything. And in our new graph, just disconnect X from U, because the elements of U, one, we want it to be dominated by the vertices in G of F. So the simple truth will help you reduce set cover problem to dynamic connected dominating set problem. And again, both these problems are equivalent. So yeah. Okay, the last problem is dynamic feedback vertex set problem. So in dynamic feedback vertex set problem, initially you are given this graph G and you are given a feedback vertex set. So if you remove the feedback vertex set, the graph below is a forest. Now you added some edges, you might have deleted some edges. So the edges that you have deleted, they are like this should be fine. The edges that you are adding, they might create new cycles. But how many such edges you are adding? At most k many. So here also we can show that if S prime is your new solution, it should contain S entirely. So S, it's safely contained inside S prime, and you can always delete this S. So once you delete this S, you have a forest and you have k edges. Now you apply your feedback vertex set rules. If there is a degree zero vertex, delete it. If there is a degree one vertex, delete it. If there is a degree two vertex, connect its both neighbors, all these things you do. Yeah.
So X prime is a solution for the new one.
Yes.
But when we remove some edges, some cycles might be deleted already, then why do we need all of S?
Yeah, because see, we want to minimize the hemming distance between S prime and S. So like it's always beneficial to include all the vertices of S into S prime. Okay, so like we had this forest on N vertices, and where we added this K edges, this is our kernel instance. So now, if we apply this degree reduction rule, that you are able to take care of degree one and degree two vertices, then how many vertices can be there in this tree, in this forest? There cannot be too many vertices, right? So you remove your S because you know S is part of your solution, and you have this forest below. And in the forest, forest plus some k edges. But now you apply your degree, like you remove your degree one and degree two vertices. Then I claim that this size of this forest, this is bounded by some linear function of k. Forest plus k. So if you have a forest plus k edges where you know there are no degree one or degree two vertices, then the number of vertices in the forest is bounded by some 2k, 3k, 4k, some order. Is it easy to see? Suppose not. Suppose you are. Suppose you have a forest. Suppose you have a forest, let's say of size k square, and how many edges you have in this graph? You had this k square size forest plus k edges, k square plus k edges, right? But you know that none of these vertices have degree zero or one. Every vertex has degree at least three. So together, all these vertices, they have at least some total of 3k square degree. So you should have at least 3k square by too many edges, but you have k square plus k edges, which is a contradiction, right? Okay. So here you can say that there cannot. So if you have a forest plus k edges, and you are able to apply the first couple of reduction rules, that you are able to get rid of degree one and degree two vertices, then after you apply these reduction rules, your forest will become really small. It will have size order k. And once you have a small kernel, you apply your feedback vertex set algorithm. So there is this algorithm for feedback vertex set. Yeah, there are this couple of algorithms for feedback vertex set. One of them runs in, runs in time. One of them runs in this time 1.667 power n, and you know your n, right? And there is another algorithm that runs parameterized by tree width 1.443 power tree width. So depending on what your n and m are, one of these algorithms will be better than the other, and you will apply the you work with the better algorithm. So these are some type problems that we considered, and some other interesting things here can be that if you allow only additions or only deletions, can you get better algorithms, so like better runtime? And there can be reconfiguration problem where you have a path and now your graph changes. So suddenly your path becomes disconnected. You have to find a new path that is that has few edges different from the original path as possible. So reconfigurations problem, like these problems, can also be considered in this model. And one very basic problem is this tree width. So given a graph G and you know its tree width, and you are given a tree decomposition. Now, if your graph suddenly has k new edges, like k edge modifications, can you find a new tree decomposition really fast? So this is one problem that has been open for quite long. Like we were unable to solve it. Yeah, but this is something to try and solve following this paper. These are some references. Yeah, that's it.
Questions? Okay, I have one question, so we are asking, thinking. I had the feeling that for maximum independence, that there was an algorithm that could work in something like 108 to the number of edges or something like that.
Yes. Yeah.
And then you could use this one in place of like where you were removing the triangles and things like that.
Yes, yes, yes. Yeah, like if it gives better runtime, yeah, for sure you can use it. Like I don't know the exact runtime. Like if it gives better runtime, you apply it directly and you get a better algorithm. So the problems are really simple. Like you can apply, like there are many algorithms for each of these problems, and you apply the best one you know. So we were more concerned about the template, if this template looks like it's a good enough template to discover many problems. So there are a lot of problems that can be optimized further that we found out later, but we didn't bother optimizing all of them.
So you were showing some bound on the tree that's based on the number of vertices and edges, you know?
Yes.
Is there any similar bound known for tree depth?
I don't know that. Tree depth, I'm not very familiar with. I only know the definition, so I can't say any bound on this.
Because if there would be such a bound, then you can probably use the general framework of Drosna and Pelepchuk to get this algorithm working in polynomial space. That's part of the framework that you can take the general approach of trees, and you are running it for tree depth, it runs in polynomial space.
Yes. Yeah.
If there are, I wanted to ask for the relation to local search. So here you modify one graph and want your solution not to be modified too much. In local search, you don't modify the graph. And the question is, like, is there a solution that doesn't differ from the given one much, but is better? So,
okay, so you try to find S prime, which is better than S, but not much different.
Yes.
Like, what is the question? Like, is there a connection?
Yes, I was wondering. Yeah, I don't know who's the question.
You don't know.
I don't remember what used to say. So there is something like this. There are some problems like this where you are given a modulator, right? You are given a modulator and you try to find a new something like iterative compression. You try to find a smaller solution. Yeah, but now you have these additional restrictions. So if you have a solution of size k, why can't you guess exactly what things go into the other solution and then you?
In local sense, we usually assume that the solution is not like the size of the solution is not our parameter.
Just the difference is
the parameter.
Okay. I have to think about it. Like, very immediate.
Fine, correct. I just to me, it also seems unnatural. Like, Pratibha asked, like, we can put the old solution in. It's somehow unnatural to keep increasing this.
Yes. So, we didn't know what to call it, so we called it dynamic parameterized framework. Otherwise, there's nothing dynamic about it. You have two different instances. You are not even trying to find optimal solution. So, like, it's just a model. Like, we didn't know what to name it, so we named it dynamic. So,
okay. If there are no further questions, then let's end.